I'm going to give you a word, and try to define it for me in, I'll make it really hard, try to define it for me in three words. No. Yeah, just go ahead and unplug it for a minute, and then as soon as it's up. These are my notes. I just sat there as I was thinking of presentation today. How would you define righteousness?
Right view.
Right viewing?
Right being.
Right being?
Pure.
Pure?
Jesus.
Jesus?
God's glory.
There's
faithful.
Faithful. Okay, our actions and God's heart in harmony. Right, we'll be in harmony. You know how difficult it is to define it? I mean, all the definitions are correct, and the definitions multiply and multiply based upon our individual experience. Suppose you could take a concept that had no word to define it. How would you communicate that concept?
That's an abstract.
It would be an abstract. That's righteousness. We have many words that say the right things based on what we're looking at. But if you were in God's place, is what I'm asking, how would you transmit the concept when there really is no word to encompass the whole thing?
Action.
Love and action.
Now I'll make it a little tougher. How would you communicate that concept to a child, an infant?
Action.
To an infant.
Action again.
Action again. And I mean righteousness in all its ramifications. Can an infant understand, you know, what marriage is all about? How would you communicate that? That's a hard job. Would you agree? That's the job that God has. Maybe it would be wise not even to try to use words. How about if you could reduce concepts to something as simple as a square? You know, children, once they get a little older, start playing with blocks. Suppose we just made a little sandbox, you can take the blocks and move around and start to build concepts. we learned, maybe the last lecture, that the big things and the small things are essentially the same. What's different is the scale. So we have some very big concepts that need to be scaled down without losing the meaning, and we call that the irreducible minimum. What's the least amount of information that still incorporates the big idea? And if you want to think about it, has the whole idea in it, like a seed in a tree. We must conceive, like DNA and a human being. If you could read DNA, which we've been able to do, we can see a lot about what the human being would be like, but not the whole thing, because a child has an environment and epigenetics that's going to determine what the child would be like and how they mature. However, how can you take the heart of God, which is infinitely complex, and bring it down to an irreducible minimum that says everything that God is?
The Alpha and the Omega.
The Alpha and the Omega. You would have to use symbols about the heart that say it all. And so, let's see if I can bring up the, just bring up the picture here. And there it is. Several years ago, there was a spacecraft called the Voyager spacecraft. You remember? Most of us, many of us, were alive at the time, and it flew all the way out to Uranus, Saturn, Uranus, Neptune. Didn't make it to Pluto. Pluto wasn't in line. But as the years went by, it went way beyond the orbit of Pluto. And someone had a bright idea. They said, it's so far out there, why don't we turn it around and take a picture of ourselves? That's what they did. And they took a picture, and that tiny little blue dot there is an actual photograph. I don't know if the light ambience is too bright. They took a picture of Earth. Now, in the Jet Propulsion Laboratory where they had the picture, it was on this huge mural. And the little dot was the size of your fingertip. And that dot was completely worn out. Because everybody would go over to it and they'd put their finger in it. And say, that's where I am. So that's where we are. Compared to the rest of the universe, which we have no idea how big it really is, it's a pretty small place. But that's not the limit of smallness. We are the apple of his eye. Yes, this planet, but also you. Imagine a creator reducing himself not only to something as small as the Earth, but then as small as a cell, as small as DNA. So the DNA, don't ask me how, but the essence of the DNA from God, I don't know how to say that properly, came all the way down and was implanted in human tissue. And that DNA was human, but it was also God. But it contained the heart of God. Jesus was the heart of God in the flesh. And his heart is the same as the heart that he gave you and me. But this time he inhabited it in the flesh. So there we are. Caught in the sunbeam. We are, in terms of scale, like that little atom that we saw before, the Schrodinger atom, in which all of the universe is concentrated on this little spot. Because it's down here that the heart is being processed to show how the heart up there works, if it's under stress. And I don't know if that's even the right word to use, but if that heart is suffering, what is it like for God to suffer? It's not a whole lot different than when you and I suffer. It's just the scale is a whole lot bigger. So if we understand how we suffer, and first we have to see what the similarities are, maybe we can understand God better. I believe that the heart of God is the mystery that was hidden for all eternity. And the first step in revealing that mystery was in the creation of you and me. In one man. Because we all have a copy, all the way back to Adam. And that man had the copy from his father, the Creator. We believe it's Jesus because it was through him that he created the worlds. Now let's look at this atom. It's only 1.1 angstroms. But I'm going to come back to the big picture again. And we're going to look at that huge nebula we saw before. And we're going to put that mirror in there between the two sides. This is a very special mirror because we're going to take the bottom side and watch what happens. The top, we're going to call it the prototype. The bottom is the image. Four hundred sixty light years on the top. The top is the cloud of witnesses. The bottom, you see what happened to the bottom? Can I do that again? Watch. What is the bottom? We're just using pictures and motifs. The bottom is the atom. The top is the nebula. So 1.1 angstroms at the bottom, 460 light years at the top. There's a mirror between the two. It's a very special mirror because the mirror is comparing likenesses. The likeness of the big piece is the same as the likeness of the small piece. The size doesn't matter anymore. That's what's neat about the mirror. That mirror we call the sanctuary. Because the sanctuary allows you to look at this side, which is infinitely large, and this side, which is infinitely small, and compare them as if they were the same size. And where does that take place? And if, of course, they are the same, then if you were to change them back and forth, you wouldn't really know the difference. Which is the picture and which is the reflection? Well, it's impossible to tell. But if up means the real, the lake is on the bottom, or the reflection is through the lake, the bottom would be the image. But we don't know. I flipped the picture around. You really can't tell. We're going to look at one of the most interesting constellations in the universe. It's called the constellation of Orion. It was known all the way back in the days of Job. And Job named those as one of the four great constellations. They studied the stars, and they named them, and this one was very prominent. I believe Ezekiel, when he was in vision, was looking up to that constellation. And what he saw, as he looked toward the heavens, he saw a whirlwind coming out of the north. And what does it say? It was a great cloud, and it was fire enfolding on itself. It was brightness all about. And in the midst thereof, the color was amber, and out of the midst of fire. This cloud was coming to him at lightning speed. And what he saw was something that he had a hard time explaining and understanding. But he saw what looked like wheels We're familiar with the passage. And these wheels had wheels inside of them, and wheels inside of them, and wheels inside of them, like the broccoli. What do we call this in mathematics? A fractal. So, what do we know about fractals? Whether you're looking at the big wheel or the little wheel, does it make any difference? It's just the same information. Now he looked at this image, and his right hemisphere does what your right hemisphere, yours and mine do, and that it is designed to look for pattern. So at first, everything looked chaotic. And then as he looked, he started to see pattern. And in that pattern, he started to make a little sense, at least. He didn't know what it meant. Now, this is a relatively simple pattern, right? It's kind of hard to program to do this. But if you had millions of these, it would get a little bit more difficult. But do you see a pattern there?
Yep.
What do you see?
3-4.
3-4. Here we go. Now, I gave you a very hard problem to work with. That was 3 times 4. Have you solved that problem yet?
You think it's 12.
It is 12.
You think.
It is 12. But 12 is a way of describing righteousness. It's the irreducible minimum of being able to describe what righteousness really is. Yes, it's a person. Yes, it is Jesus. But the function of his heart is described by a combination of 3 and 4. Now, as we will see. The appearance of the wheels was Burl, and the likeness thereof was, did I say that already? And it was as if a wheel was in a wheel. And what else does the scripture say? Revelation says that before the throne, John saw kind of the same thing. And what he says is that he saw, I better look this way, this is too small to read. He saw 4 living creatures around the throne. One was like a, first was a lion, then the second was a calf, the third was a man, and the fourth was an eagle. Now, isn't that strange? Doesn't it strike you as kind of unusual that up there are animals? Are there any animals up there? What can you tell me about those animals? There's something that's common about all of those 4 animals, and I'm not including man as the king of animals.
They're all in one.
They're all in one?
Yeah.
And of course, there's no picture of them, is there yet? I need to put a picture of them. Let's put the picture first. There we go. What can you tell me? What's common about those 4?
They all have eyes and they all breathe.
They all breathe, they all have eyes? I'll tell you what's common. They are all kings. Mm-hmm. Now it's easy, the man is king of the animals, right? The lion is also a king of a certain type. He's a king. There's a lot of other animals that are like him, but he's the king of that type, and the ox is a king of a certain type. And the eagle is a king of a certain type. There is not a chapter or a verse that I know of in Scripture that will say the ox stands for, the ox that you saw is such and such. Like Revelation will say, the waters that you saw are peoples. However, the entire Scripture uses this in such a big way that it's like the elephant in the room. How do we miss it? It's the motif of everything. So we don't need to have a chapter and verse. The whole scripture whole chapters, whole books, the whole motif, it's just the whole thing is based on one of those four symbols. And all about the throne thereof is the likeness, of course, of the living creatures. And it says every one of them had four faces. So there's four of them, but each one had four. So let's see if we can bring that in. What else does it say? Let's say the same thing. Ezekiel 1:10, they four had a face of an ox on the left, and the four also had the face of an eagle. So let's do that. We're going to put a lion on each of them. This is where you just, you know, just keep your visual cortex. And an ox and an eagle. Do you still grab it? Of course, if it got worse and worse and worse, you know, you can simply know that it's always four and four and four. And in the midst of all that, was a lamb. Well, let's take all the noise out of the picture and just look at one part. Because if all those circles are based on kind of the same thing, the four faces, then why don't we just take one of the circles and maybe that will answer the question of the rest of them. Does that sound like a fair assumption? So you see there's four everywhere you turn, right? Four, four, four. And of course, if we were to go smaller to those little ones, we have four again. If we go smaller again, we'd be four again. just too hard to graphically draw it here. So he saw, it says in Ezekiel, that whenever these faces moved in heaven to the right, the ones on earth, and then when they went up, everything on earth went up, and then when they went left. And so the faces up there and the faces down here are moving in a synchronous motion. So there's a relationship between the two. The big one and the little one are moving like this. Very important. Could it be that they're linked in some way? And so, this earth, before creation, was without form and void. It was just a cloud. Who knows? You know, maybe like Jupiter, who knows? It was maybe a rocky core or something. And so, we had an event that took place in which heaven came very close to this little dark blob and spoke order out of chaos. And in the cloud, I'm placing four faces because in every cloud in Scripture, there's always four faces. So I'm sure they were there in the beginning, the first time. And then a little later, in history, around 1445 BC, there was a mysterious statement coming from heaven that said, "Let them make me a sanctuary that I may dwell among them. And make it after the pattern of the one up there." So, the faces are the same pattern, we think, because they move like this, one on earth and one on heaven. And so we're going to go down, a little smaller, until we can find the meaning of these four faces. Right down to that little spot on planet Earth. Do you know where that is? Israel. That is the Sinai Peninsula. It's where the children of Israel camped after they left Egypt. And down to that spot came this pattern that had two squares in it. One on the left and one on the right. And as we've been talking about for the last couple of 3 hours or so, is that anytime you have something on the left and something on the right, it's saying the same thing, but it's saying it in one language, verbal language, and then it's saying nonverbal language. It's saying it in a digital way and then in an analog way, however we want to communicate that idea. So we're going to go down that little place and take a look. Do you see the faces in the clouds? They're always there. But they won't make sense to us unless they are in a certain order. And so we're going to take those faces and just put them in a little square, because a square is a symbol of the heart in Scripture. So just organize it into the form of a square, and let's go down and take a look. See, did I go too fast? Do you see the little yellow line there for me? That's the journey that the children of Israel took as they left Egypt, across the Red Sea, and they ended up at that little tiny spot, and then let's go down. Don, did you ever take a tour?
No, I haven't been there.
I had the privilege of going to this spot, of course that's just a painting, which pretty good, I would say about 99% sure that this is the location that they have now, we're present on Sinai. Do you notice anything? I'll point it out. The children of Israel are camped on how many sides? Four? Now the painting, of course, doesn't really display what we're showing in those little circles. But those circles are a banner that each tribe would carry. One on the east side had a symbol of this. There we go. Did I go too fast? Okay, I guess they're all coming together. The east side had the lion, the west side had the ox, the south side had the man, the north side had the eagle. And these were human beings carrying a banner. Interesting. Same basis. Over the children of Israel was a cloud, and I just made it kind of fiery looking. It was a fire, a pillar by day. I'm sorry, a pillar by night, and a covering by day. So I just made it kind of like fiery. And we know that in 1 Corinthians 10:4, it says that they all drank of that spiritual rock that, that followed them. Or went with them, the better translation, and that rock was Christ. So inside that cloud was Christ. Could you see him? You couldn't see his face. All you could see is a cloud. However, when Moses went up into the mount, he saw a pavement up there, and the feet of God standing on that sapphire pavement. On earth, we have the peoples on earth, I'll just make a sapphire pavement there, and on that pavement I'm putting the four faces, because four faces, as we will soon see, are always associated with the cloud. On earth, we have water, because the peoples are water. This is very special water, because it's organized water. It's not, it's chaotic, but it's organized. And you also have them carry a banner. So you have two surfaces, a watery surface, a sapphire surface, and four corners on each, so to speak. It is as if heaven and earth came to a touching point right there in the desert plains. And in that point of contact, you had an image above, and there's the one above, and an image below. So our job is we want to be able to read the image below, because Jesus was in the cloud above, but he was also in the cloud below. So it's, God kind of has a sense of humor, because he takes things and turns them on their head. So the cloud casts a shadow on earth, but the information is in the shadow. You can't go inside the cloud and figure out what's going on, but you can look at the shadow and see what's up here. Kind of the same. You can't go inside a cloud today and see the weather, but you can send Doppler radar in there and through calculations draw a picture of what's going on inside. So, we cannot enter the presence of God. There was only one being that really could before the fall, that was Lucifer. He could go in, and he had the mental capacity to understand what's going on. It takes a lot of calculation to see, to figure out weather, because you can't see it with your natural eye. You see the effects of it, but you can't see the graphs and interactions. And so a plan is built to create an image down here that we can all see and touch. And that image is made out of people, and remember that people are built for relationships. How do relationships work? And what is the science? Let's put it this way. Scientists have been looking for years for what they call the universal field theory. Any scientists? You know, what is it that puts gravity and the electrical forces and the forces between the atoms? And find one formula that puts it all together. Well, they haven't found it yet. The sanctuary is the universal theorem or formula that puts the law, the written law, and the emotional law together. And every other law, every other science, as long as we're studying creation, it puts it all together, and it's the universal theorem, or universal, what should we say? Formula of righteousness, how's that? if we understand this formula, we can see the face of Jesus, even though we can't see it. Because did you know that that's how our brains work right now? Is that when I'm looking at you, I'm not just looking at your face, I'm looking at the person behind the face. People with Asperger's, if it's severe enough, they don't see the person behind the face, they just see a talking face. And so it's hard to have a relationship. But the reason that we see behind the face is because our left eye is wired to our right hemisphere and communicates how I really feel about you. And I can't lie, nor you. That's why we get embarrassed and things like that. Because within a sixth of a second, we've already made three shots back and forth about how we really feel about each other. And what happens is that if it's not working too well, I jump to my left hemisphere and put on this, the left hemisphere, the camera smile. Because the camera smile is produced from an entirely different set than what we call the cingulate cortex smile. The cingulate cortex smile is genuine. It's coming from joy. The camera smile is used in a whole different muscle group, and you can tell the difference. I have a photograph, I haven't found it, but it's two children side by side, And you just look at it. Everybody knows the camera smile. Everybody knows the genuine smile. It's just, and I ask, everybody says, yes, well, I'm right. We're left where we're supposed to be. In Revelation, John tells the angel, I want you to do something. I'm sorry, the angel tells John, I want you to do something. I want you to take a reed like a rod and go measure three things. I want you to measure this, the temple. That's pretty easy. It was 50 by 100 cubits. Then I want you to measure this. That's pretty easy. That's the altar. We don't know if it was the altar of sacrifice or the altar of incense, one was inside or both. But they both have the dimensions and we can measure them. But then it says, I want you to measure one more thing. I want you to measure that. Now, when we talk about measurement, it means only one thing. It means measure. Whether we are taking a literal ruler or whether we're thinking about how it works, we're quantifying it. You have to quantify the measure. So I want you to go out to this turbulent water out here, because the Bible refers to them as unstable as water. And I want you to be able to quantify this thing that never stands still. Before GPS was invented, I want you to go to such and such a location in the ocean. How do you get? How do I get back to where I was? There is no way to figure that out. But we have studied the sanctuary doctrine from the standpoint of the furniture, but we have never measured the people. That's the impossible. But what is the biggest square? Sanctuary is big, then what's the biggest square? The people. The people are the biggest square. If you want to study truth, you always start with the big picture. The biggest one you can find. Then you work your way in. So you'll find truth in here, but you'll find the proper setting with the biggest ring you can find. And so that ring in heaven was the biggest ring up there in heaven. It was the four creatures. And if they were a square on earth, they were probably a square up there, if the image is the same. So we'll start with the guardians, and I'm going to call them the guardians that guard the boundaries of the emotional world. That's who they are. Because the emotional world is the biggest world there is. And two things to go together, this physical world and the spiritual world. If you put them together, what do you get? Where is the physical world and the spiritual world best integrated? Until they are one thing. Happens right there. That's where the spiritual and physical world meet. They meet in this dark cloud inside our heads that nobody knows what's, for a thousand years, nobody knows what's going on in there. if you open up to look, you kill the person. There's nothing to study. So, you can't enter into the presence of God and figure out what's going on. You have to be told, you have to have an illustration that won't harm you. Because we don't have the capacity to sit in the center of absolute intense joy. What's the definition of joy? Those of you who are here? What's the neurological and biblical definition of joy? It's the same definition. It means someone is genuinely glad to be with me. And that is what our brains see. If we were in the midst of someone who was intensely glad to be with us, with such intensity, just like the attraction in marriage, you couldn't stand it very long, the intensity, just like your tickling turns into pain, our human frame cannot handle absolute intense joy. So let's look for a pattern, because I won't back up, but there were four sides, right? How many tribes on each side?
Four.
I mean, I know what you meant. There were four sides and three on each side. Okay, let's go looking in a couple places, a few examples. There's hundreds and hundreds of examples. We know there's four seasons. How many months for each season? Okay, there's three, four. Let's look at the microscopic world. The carbon, we are a carbon-based creation. And here is kind of an illustration of the lattice network. Every carbon-based molecule is built upon three families of four particles. Here is an actual electron microscope, or I think it's a field tunneling microscope, of the surface of the metal. Those are the actual atoms you're looking at. And it's always in a 3-4 combination. What's the function? The function of the carbon-based system is to gather and to solidify. He spoke, and it stood fast. Let's take a look at another area. There's many ways of illustrating DNA. And for your interest, that's a nebula. Interesting, isn't it? So let's look at the biological realm. The biological realm, what's the DNA composed of? It's three chemical groups and four nucleotides. You and I, we're all based on that. A 3-4 combination. What's the purpose of this 3-4 combination? The function is to repeat and amplify. We are all created to be fruitful and multiply after our own kind. And so, isn't it interesting that we are, in this period of time, that we are working on re-engineering? Mm-hmm. We're starting with plants. What are we doing with this image? We're crossing species now. Let's try another round. Let's try the cosmos. This is relatively simple, this particular one. I mean, we're just looking at the visual, right? If you were to look at the Orion Nebula, if you could be way off in space and look at it from another side, what would you see? Those three stars in the center form a triangle that, with its ladder pointing straight down on this Earth, it's a ladder from heaven to Earth. Mm-hmm. If you were to stretch it out and look at it from its side. But at our distance, it's just a flat surface. Well, what's the purpose? The foundation of all the cosmos is built upon three dimensions and the fourth we know is time. And that is also scriptural. We'll see in the next hour that it's exactly how God has organized this. It has four dimensions. And he's using time as a measure to put down, to scale out emotions. What's the function? The function is equilibrium. Gravity is what pulls this all together. The slightest change, you know, point, and the thing goes into chaos. Okay, when I look at the big picture, I think, well, how are you mindful of me? I'm the tiniest circle in this whole thing. How do you keep track of me? Well, back to the sanctuary. The congregation was to camp a distance way out. They couldn't get too close. It's almost like the sanctuary is sitting on an island, and it rises up out of the water, and the waves of the water come yay far and further, just like on the beach. So the Israelites, you know, there's commotion out there, but you can't come any further. There's an invisible boundary there, just like there's an invisible boundary with water. We're not afraid of it, because it has already been established thus far and no further, unless you have a tsunami or something. So we're going to take a look at that boundary, and we're going to look at those clouds that came down to earth to represent God's people. God's people are a cloud. They are 12 clouds. So let's just put them in space, and then we'll put them on the desert floor. Then we'll put them in space again, because whether it's the sand of the skies or the sand of this earth, it's the same thing. Now, I'll go very fast now. Numbers chapter 2 says that on the east, Judah will carry the standard of the lion. Next to him will be Issachar. Next to him, Zebulun. Reuben, the man. Next to him, Simeon. Next to him, Gad. Ephraim carries the ox. Next to him is Manasseh. And then Benjamin. Dan carries the flag of the eagle. And then Asher and Naphtali. Do you see the tribes in the sky? Do you see the heart of God in the sky? Is what I'm asking. What does it mean? It's the same function that's in here. And what is the function? The realm of God's people, which is really simply a sample of humanity, the realm of humanity is social. What is the foundation? It's three bonds, and composed of four families, or we could say it is three bonds composed of four clusters of emotional maturity. Four stages of joy strength. Four different types of joy strength. Four hierarchical stages. In other words, one, and then two, and three, and four. If you knock out one, you've knocked out two, three, and four. If you've knocked out two, you've knocked out three and four. What's the function of this arrangement? It's to create order out of chaos. That's what that square actually achieves. So we're going to look at time, because that was the measuring stick that the angel said, I want you to measure God's people. God's people are measured in time. They're measured through history. That's the only scale that there is, that's quantifiable. I'm losing track of time. How much time do we have?
Do what you gotta do.
When I get to the stop point, we're gonna stop at a very important point. So I'll just, thank you. Time is a fractal. There was a 1260-year time that the man of sin reigned. There was a 1260-day period of time that the man of righteousness reigned. Isn't that right? 3.5 years. What's the intersection of the two? One very right hemispheric, one very left hemispheric based. The man of righteousness was entirely, his life was composed of what we would call emotional obedience. He spent his time looking at his father's face. He knew what his father was like, and he did what it was like his father to do, because he looked at his father's face. The other system looked at another face, which was a problem-solving face. And that's every time I run into a spiritual problem or a relational problem, we kill it. We micromanage it. We make the pain stop. We make vows. We make dictums. We make, what's another word I'm looking for? When a church makes a whole statement that it doesn't move from, is it good for that? Well, yes, you could say mission statement, but you go back to doctrine, getting warmer, but anyway, come to us. A bold would be good.
Creed,
that's the word I'm looking for. Thank you. We're going to make a creed that stops the pain from hurting me, because a creed means this is the one solution for all. Never mind how you feel about it. Just stop it. And so every time a problem come up, this is how we solve them. And so it turns into a monster after a while, because there can be no freedom. Because individual expression has to be eliminated in order for there to be peace of a sort. Well, the fractal of time creates a year-day principle in which the reign of one man is undone in days what it took years to do. It took 1260 years to create a left hemispheric image of righteousness. Something that quacked like a duck, looked like a duck, but it wasn't a duck. You know what I'm saying? It was just a picture of one. But there wasn't any love in it, but it looked like it could love. The problem is that it had one fundamental flaw, and that was it was built upon the principle of fear. But then in 1260 literal days, you had a man, one man, a little tiny circle, who represents all the big circles. All the big circles were inside of him, in which he had complete freedom of movement, because in his right prefrontal cortex, he could see the big picture all the time. He could see what is inside your heart and my heart. He could see the motivation. But his job was not to judge. His job was to free you so that you could also live from your own identity. So he went around giving belonging and identity.
Amen.
And from belonging and identity, everything else starts to grow. As soon as we know who we are, then we start to act like my people from above, out of our own personality. And when we act out of our own personality, it's beautiful because it's unique, it's original, and it's life-giving. If you go from the left hemisphere, then you have uniformity, where everything has to apply according to one formula. There's no formula on the right side. So in 1260 days, everything was undone that took 160 years to build. What's that saying?
5 minutes.
Saying, it's very easy to live in the right hemisphere. Just live how we're designed. It's very hard to build up a system to make it look like this one, and yet none of it is able to function by itself. It is not a standalone system. The moment you remove the power, everything collapses, which is the way it is with all fear-based systems. Let's look at historical time. In chronology, we have events and dates, but we also have movements in time that go through hundreds of years. Together, what does that look like? You have a point in time and an event that might take hundreds of years. What you're saying is that this one point equals this huge event, like 1260 years is a huge period of time, that something took place that's identifiable within that period of time that is the same thing that took place in 1 year. Event and span are interchangeable. One equals all equals one. That's what's being said in time. So, have you ever noticed this book is not chronological? It's really hard to put it in chronological order. Why didn't God just put it in chronological order? I mean, it would make more sense. It would make more left hemisphere sense. But it is in order. Do you know what order it's in? It's in a 3-4 order. It's ordered in the same order that we process emotional pain. That's how it's ordered. It's kind of a nice order. And that is why I think we said the other night, whenever you're exposed to anything that's in a 3-4 pattern, because it has to be in creation, this is inspired by the Creator. It's a work of man and God together. Men who were inspired by the Spirit wrote, and as they wrote in a format that does four things and three things at the same time. And whenever that happens, our brain looks at that and says, boy, that's just like me. That's just like, you know, that's a reflection. I like that. That feels good. If I read something only from the left hemisphere, it's like, feels like I'm studying. Feels like I'm cramming for a test. You know, ask me a half hour later, I have no idea what I just read it. But if we read something that's inspired, we will remember it because it matches the way in which we process emotions. Three? Okay. We're going to stop. And I want you to think about this question. How old is the earth and why does it matter? And what does that have to do with your brain? Your heart. You know, how old is the earth and who cares? And what does that have to do with emotions? Think that's a fair question? It's not one we usually ask. What does it have to do with the emotional recovery? And so we'll be looking to that question, and we'll be looking at a little bit of chronology, just to be able to build a framework, and it's real simple. And then we'll look at the waves that pass through history, and just see what they look like. Then we'll look at the brain, inside the brain. Okay, we'll take a break, and I'll ask you a question when we start.